The Delta Pro Ultra on paper is the unit of the summer. It's one of our favorite brand new power stations, yet some of the smaller and less popular ones, as we just found out, have kind of been outperforming this thing. Regardless, today we're going to be looking at what this power station can and cannot do by putting it through some testing to help you guys find out if this is the power station for you. You guys know here at the lab, our opinions cannot be bought. If you guys are not familiar with the Delta Pro Ultra, we've already done a full review video, which I will leave a link to in the description down below, as well as links to the unit and whatever else you might be interested in. Otherwise, let's jump into the results of our testing and show you guys exactly what this thing can and cannot do. We're gonna get started with some baseline testing on this unit before we jump into some of the bigger stuff. And before we do anything, I just wanna say this is a video on a Delta Pro Ultra. Not two Delta Pro Ultras and not the Delta Pro Ultra with the smart home panel, although we do have the smart home panel and another Delta Pro Ultra, which we will come at in a later video. Today we're looking at this exact setup that you're seeing right now. So jumping in to some of the just basic standard tests that we basically run all of our power stations through, starting with efficiency. Efficiency is important because if this is a 6,000 watt hour battery and you had a 1500 watt air conditioner, you would expect this unit to be able to run the air conditioner for 4 hours. If this is only 75% efficient, your air conditioner would only run for 3 hours. So it's really important to know because a lot of times people are deceived by the size of the battery they're working with and they don't realize that the fans and the inverter running actually consumes power as well. This is a 6,000 watt hour battery and a 7,200 watt inverter. So we ran an almost 6,000 watt load to get this right near the top of the inverter's capacity. So it should have lasted right about 60 minutes. It actually lasted 59 minutes. Which is really impressive. That makes this power station 98% efficient, which is really, really good. And this unit stayed pretty cool throughout. The battery wire right here that plugs the battery into the actual inverter was extremely hot after the testing. We have this little top-down thermal camera thing that they sent us that we've been messing with. It's actually pretty cool. Nothing got extremely hot. You guys can see the heat sinks are hot, but there's no like obvious hotspots or anything on the unit. Second test is charge speed. So you can charge this thing 20 different ways. We went ahead and did the charge speed test on a reliable 120 volt house plug. That is like the most common way people will probably charge this unit. And it charges at about 1800 watts from the house plug. So it should have charged in about 3 hours and 20 minutes. It actually charged in 4 hours and 4 minutes. Something interesting too, is it used 7.25 kilowatts to charge a 6,000 watt battery bank. That's just something good to know. In terms of surge testing, this is a 7,200 watt inverter. I ran a 9,200-ish watt load on this guy. Only lasted about 10 seconds. It didn't last very long at all, but it did last.
9,300 watts. That was actually really impressive.
A lot of times when you surge a unit past its rated output at all, it's like a blip and then it's off. So good job for working. And in terms of solar input, this unit's actually really nice. It has a low voltage solar input right here. And you also have a high voltage solar input on the side. And this unit did just fine. Any solar size that we hooked this thing up to, it performed. And there's no restrictions, the volts, the amps, everything lines up. Unlike some of the other bigger units like the F3800, which actually has a weird problem where it was designed to work with anchor panels. So the amperage rating is too low for you to get the maximum solar input into the unit, unless you're using anchor panel. This thing does not have that problem. The solar input is just fine. We had no issues. Even has a nice little logo on the screen to tell you if you're charging with low or high solar input. When it comes to sound testing, this unit, dead silent. It's probably the best unit that we have seen so far. And the last baseline test for the Delta Pro Ultra is pass-through. Now this is really important because if your battery say is at 10% and you're about to run a bunch of power out of this unit, you need a way to be able to charge it and use it at the same time. So pass-through just means either you have solar coming into this or AC power coming into this. It's giving power to your devices and then putting the rest into your battery. This is the first spot where this unit kind of annoys me. It's not alone. A lot of portable power stations actually have this problem. It does pass through some stuff. It passes solar through, no problem. You can have solar coming into this unit. You could be using the plugs on the front. You're fine. You can have AC power, 120 or 240, going into this unit and using the 120 volt plugs on the front, and you're fine. The thing that this unit does not do is pass power through to this plug. which is your generator plug, your L14, which makes no sense because this is a big unit, dude. It's designed to power a garage, a house, a cabin, something. This is, you're not meant to, you can't even access 7,200 watts out of these plugs. You can only access under 5,000 watts out of these 120 volt plugs on the front because they're 20 amp plugs. To even take advantage of the full size of this inverter, you need to be using this. And I found out, disappointingly, that as soon as you put AC power into this, it shuts that power off.
What?
All the lights go out in the garage and you're over. So if it's not a sunny day, and you're running a gas generator or you plug it into another kind of generator to get power into this, you're fucked. When it comes to running realistic power tests off the Delta Pro Ultra, it has the L14 plug right here, your generator plug, and a dedicated 30 amp. So you'll either have this plugged directly into your RV, into a transfer switch, into your smart home panel, whatever. So first off, when we're looking at what can this thing run, yes, it can run a fridge. Fridges take like no power, okay? Like a full size, my full size fridge, when it's running, takes like 125 watts, and fridges run for like 5-10 minutes, they cool down and then they shut off again for like the rest of the hour. This is a pretty powerful unit. It's 7,200 watts, it can do a lot. It can run a microwave, it can run your dryer, it can run your stove, it can run your oven. It can run your oven and your stove and your microwave and a coffee maker all at the same time.
So for reference, we can literally bake at 350. There it is. We can turn on this giant double element in the front, and we can also microwave something well within our 7,200 watt limit. You know, we can even make a pot of coffee at the same time. There you go. It's really not, like, it's actually a really powerful little unit.
The good news here is that the Delta Pro can surge within what it's kind of designed to do, like run a kitchen load. It can run multiple burners and the oven and the microwave and do all this stuff. It can do all that because the surges aren't crazy high.
Where it's running into an issue is in our next test, where we kind of use some more heavy duty equipment.
Appliances like that, they don't have a really high surge capacity. They just kind of come on. So you can stack that number really, really easily. We really had no issues with household testing. I was actually really impressed. I got this thing to 83 or something, 100 watts in the kitchen at one point, and it just kept going.
How many burners can we do at once? That's the question. Let's put this guy on, and we'll put this guy on. Oh yeah, we're surging. We're surging hard. We are surging for a long time. Okay, well, this isn't actually very impressive. What if we add one more? Dude, who set the limiter on this thing? It's a 7,200 watt inverter, we're running 93, oh, there it goes.
I was really impressed with that. There was nothing that we found that it couldn't do in terms of like household appliances or any weird quirky things, which is kind of unfortunate because sometimes finding quirky things makes me feel like I really tested it. But in this case, I think it's just a kudos to the Delta Pro Ultra for actually being a quality unit.
It should be able to handle this no problem.
Now here comes the good stuff. We ran this through a high demand test at the shop. Everything that we power at the shop is a lot different than the things that we power at the house because they all surge. When you turn it on, the electricity spikes to get that thing spinning, moving, pumping, whatever it is that you're doing. There's a surge of electricity before it levels out and uses its very small, like probably 2000 watt load. And so that's where this thing actually kind of let us down a little bit, which was surprising. So this power station has no problem running base loads. Obviously, plug it in, turn on all the lights at the shop, 400 watts, throw the heater on, it's another 300 watts. It can handle that no problem. It can also turn on my compressor.
It did it. It didn't sound the best, but it did it. Didn't want to do it twice though.
Barely. You guys can see the lights flicker super aggressively when you do it, but it can do it. It can't run my car lift, and I do not understand why. The lift is only 2,200 watts, but for some reason, the way this unit outputs power, it stutters.
Not good.
If you listen to me using my lift with the F3800 or even with just grid power, it sounds smooth and proper. This sounds jittery. And that's not good for the motor, first of all. If it sounds like that, don't do it. I don't know why this unit doesn't want to do the lift. And I know you guys are already down in the comments hosing me for using an adapter from this to the 50 amp plug. So to make sure that I address this in the same video, now that you guys are done smashing your keyboard around, I actually wired in a completely new transfer switch to the garage because I didn't have the right cable to go from L14 to the 50 amp. So I wired in a whole new transfer switch, plugged this directly into the new transfer switch with one cable, exact same result. Don't hate the player, hate the power station, all right? I'm just trying to show you guys the results. Otherwise, it can do most things individually in the garage. It can run a table saw, it can run a chop saw, it can run the compressor, it can do the lights. We've already determined a lot. So what I wanted to know was, where's the limits of this thing? Final test for this guy is everything and the kitchen sink. We're starting at 380 watts. That's just a floating number that keeps the lights on and the outlets charged. We're gonna start with the heater. That's something I would always have on in my shop. In the wintertime, it just ignited and then it's gonna turn on the fan in a second. Honestly, the heater doesn't take that much power, but for me, it's like if you're trying to measure off of a baseline in the winter, this is my baseline. Heater on, lights on. It's not a lot to ask for. All right, let's have fun. I'm gonna start with the sketchiest one first. Another 1,000 watts. All right, let's see if it'll do the table saw. It will not do the table saw.
Now that's disappointing because the F3800, which has a 6,000 watt inverter with a 9,000 watt surge, so smaller inverter than this, it first of all can run the hoist without making weird sounds. But when I ran it through the same test, it did the compressor, it did the shop vac, it did the table saw, then it also then did another saw, and it tried to do the hoist.
All right, let's add 1,000 watts to it. Table saw. Doesn't want to do the hoist.
This couldn't do it, which is just weird. And this had actually the exact same results. So when we didn't turn the compressor on, we could turn on the shop vac, 1,000 watts, turn on the table saw, turn on the chop saw, that was fine, everything was good. And then when you go use the hoist, even with the compressor off, it surges aggressively enough that the table saw turns off.
1,000 watts. Get the table saw going. Chop saw. Maybe the hoist?
For some reason, the shuttering must have just caused that to internally trip, which actually is good. I should make sure it works.
Yeah, okay, so it just internally tripped, which is actually nice to know it does.
It's just, to me, that's weird. It's almost like this is a little over-specced on the inverter and surge capacity and stuff, and the F3800 is under-specced. As always, this is never a perfect science. Everybody's loads are unique to them. If you guys are interested in this, if it passed enough of the tests to qualify for you and your needs, we have some links to it down below. Shop Solar actually has a $500 coupon that we will leave down below as well. If you purchase this thing, that's where we would recommend you guys go anyways. Otherwise, that is it. That is all we got for you guys today. Make sure you guys are subscribed if you are not already. Thank you guys so much for watching, and we will catch you in the next one. Peace out and stay charged, and comment any other tests that you would have liked to see us include in these testing videos, because this is the first one that we've actually published. So I'm sure that we left out some things, or you guys probably have some questions or whatever. So let us know. Peace out and stay charged.